Okay, I heard earlier today that the absolute worst time to give a presentation was at 1 in the afternoon right after lunch. He was a liar. This is the worst time to give a presentation because we all want to get out of here and go on to social activities. Am I bellowing loud enough in the back of the room? Okay. What we're going to do is pull a Monty Python and do now for something completely different. We've been hearing an awful lot about the characterization, how asteroids are put together. We've talked a lot about the effects of impacts, and we know that there are folks out there looking at potential deflection methods. What is missing is a link in the chain, which I call Natural Impact Warning Command and Control. And the Natural Impact Warning has a bit of a history. This presentation had its origin in a presentation I made while on active duty in the Air Force to the commander of the Cheyenne Mountain Operations Center, the NORAD Cheyenne Mountain Center, and trying to get them to buy into this as an Air Force mission. I'm here, so obviously we did not succeed at that point, but the command and control portion is something that we have to be able to do. We have to go from the point where we know we have a potentially hazardous asteroid heading towards us and make that link to the people who are going to decide what to do about it. And what I'm going to give you today is probably the absolute worst thing to do at this point in time, but you're going to get it anyway. I've viewed this in a format that I'm used to, which is developing a set of requirements to go get something or build something. What we're trying to put together is a process that goes from detection of asteroids all the way to dealing with a potentially hazardous one. I'm looking at that little link in the middle, and we're going to talk about the requirements to do this command and control. And we're going to step through things that you normally find when you look at making requirements. For those that have been in the military, this is a typical process. For those of you that haven't, I will try not to be too dull and boring. What I did at the outset was set a fundamental requirement. And there it is. The fundamental issue is to notify U.S. national leadership of an impending natural object impact in sufficient time and with sufficient information to take the appropriate action. The very first thing I've got to say on this slide is I very deliberately limited my discussions to the United States. We'll talk about international implications towards the end, but the very short version of this is the United States has a method to do this command and control to respond to emergencies. Other nations have it as well. I happen to know the U.S.'s version of it. And for a lot of reasons, we'll touch on later, I suspect that the first time we run into this in real life, it ain't going to be coordinated, and nations will respond on their own for a period of time. So, what we're going to do is take that fundamental requirement apart, and then look at the pieces and see what we have to do. And what I've done is decompose it. There's the core. We're going to talk about each one of these four pieces. A quick definition for each of them first. Shown here. Notification, clear, telling the national leadership what it needs to know. Timeliness, being able to do it quickly enough to begin to craft a response. Sufficient information, here's a tough one, and it is tough, having enough information to make decisions. And this audience might be surprised to know that what we know about asteroids probably is not sufficient. The knowledge of asteroids isn't sufficient because there's a lot of other issues that come to play. We'll talk about those. Finally, somebody has to propose what to do, a course of action. Take a look at each one of those, and I'm going to take a look at them from the perspective of shortfalls. This isn't meant to poke anybody in the eye. This is meant to kind of set the current state of the art. What do we do today? We'll start with notification. Let me start on the right side of the slide because I lived through this one. A Delta II, the second stage, re-entered the atmosphere back in January of 97. They do this all the time. What they don't do all the time is survive to impact on the surface. That's pretty rare. And what does get down is pretty solid steel and titanium. This one came down just outside of Texas. As a matter of fact, this one came down right next to someone's chicken coop, I believe. I don't think I'm kidding on that one. When it hit, nobody got hurt, nobody got killed. Property damage was basically a hole in the ground in a farmer's backyard. But because of the potential for bad publicity, damage, death, U.S. Space Command revamped the entire process that it uses to work on these reentries, and for the first time, as a matter of fact, began to work on methods to predict impact points, actual latitude and longitude impact points. I can attest to the fact that there was probably, just because of this event, 6 months of frenetic activity in Colorado Springs to improve how we predicted that. Let's flip to a friend of ours, 97XF11. Impact was predicted in 2028. That could have been pretty ugly. Doesn't look like it's going to be. It's not clear to those of us outside the community that there was any fundamental change in how we deal with information like that. And I'll be coming back to that particular event and how it's perceived outside the community, because that's where I stand. So I would submit that we have shortfalls in how we go about notifying our leadership. I would also submit we've got shortfalls in how we deal with timeliness. This is a very notional, with no analysis behind it, timeline. What I'm trying to point out is if we were to just arbitrarily say that between detection of a potentially hazardous asteroid and its predicted impact, we had a decade, just to pick a round number. Then there's an awful lot that's got to go on in that decade. If you take the 0 point as predicted impact, by which you have to have done something to mitigate or prevent that impact, you start to back it up. There could be many, many months where you're applying your response. If you're not going to bomb this, and that's probably not the best idea, you're going to deflect it in some fashion, you're going to be applying energy or thrust to that object for quite a period of time to divert it sufficiently. That will be many months. It takes a while to get to the asteroid, depending on where it is. Now, I've arbitrarily picked a few years, purely arbitrary, but then it's purely arbitrary as to where it's going to be in its orbit. The things that begin to really eat your time is the development of what that response is going to be. It's been pointed out several times, certainly by Andy Smith, that we don't have a tool or a toolkit to go to yet. And we probably won't develop one until we have to. That's going to take several years. There's a period of time between discovery of this potentially hazardous asteroid and when you think you can begin to really tell people about it. Now, I've arbitrarily put 12 months there. And it might be 12 days, it might be 12 hours, but there is a period of time there. So I say that there's relatively small amount of time available for warning. And for me, warning isn't just the initial notification. Warning goes all the way through from initial notification to your leadership, be it national or international, deciding on a course of action that they're going to pursue. What is that response? That's going to take time. So not a lot of time to warn, and that's what we're focusing on. And it's pretty apparent to me that this question of timeliness is not really the top of everybody's minds. Information sufficiency is a tough one. We've talked a bit about that today. We're not even sure what the threat is made of. Getting better, but we're not even sure what it's made of. Certainly 5 years ago, when the Air Force and NASA and whatnot were quite interested in planetary defense, there was a lot less knowledge than there is now. With 97XF-11, when it was first detected, there were relatively few observations, and the orbits computed on the basis of those observations showed it was possible that there might be an impact. The people that did those computations knew what they had. They knew they had very preliminary results. They knew they had a very large error ellipse. But the information got to the press, and I think you all remember what happened. And it's key. That reaction is key, because the policymakers aren't going to pay attention to the astronomers. They're going to pay attention to the reaction in the population at large. What was perceived is that under extreme pressure, that orbit was recomputed with a few bits of data that were found earlier, and golly gee, we're going to be missed. Now, the reality is different, and we know that. Not a whole lot different. But the perception was we didn't have our act together. Data wasn't sufficient, and it wasn't handled to provide it, to explain it in proper form. Final shortfall, the final one of the four, is developing that course of action. And this, I think, is one that absolutely nobody is dealing with. What has to be done is to answer the, all right, now what, question. The reason, when I presented the predecessor briefing to the Brigadier General in charge of Cheyenne Mountain, he listened very politely, let me spend 20 minutes of his time, and then told me that he was not going to recommend this go up the chain of command to headquarters of the U.S. Space Command, which is only about two or three people. The reason was that nobody had any idea what to do about the problem. I argue that's a real bad answer. Okay? To be brutally honest, in 1947, when the Russians detonated their first thermonuclear weapon, we had no clue what we were going to do to stop them from delivering it. In the early 50s, when they finally flew their first ballistic missile, we were absolutely flabbergasted, as I'm sure they were by our flight tests, because nobody had any idea what to do to stop the delivery of a nuclear weapon on a ballistic missile. That didn't stop us from making sure that we knew it was coming. And as time went on, a lot of answers surfaced. I would submit we're in the same boat. We may not know now, but we will know. And in the meantime, we've got to be able to identify what it is we want to tell the President, the Secretary General, the Premier, what it is we want him to do. If we don't tell him that, we've wasted a heck of a lot of time and energy. Now, the real bad news is that the two parties in the government that are responsible for dealing with this are either ignoring it or pointing the finger at somebody else. I exchanged emails with the folks in the NEO program. Their answer is they expect DOD to answer this call when the time comes. Unfortunately, you have to have tools and procedures to deal with that. DOD is doing nothing to deal with this, as we are well aware. So, at the moment, it's an awful lot of this. Nobody is developing courses of action. We have got to do that. Otherwise, there's not a whole lot of point in telling the President that in 12 months it's all over. Okay, those are the shortfalls, and it sounds pretty bleak, and it's not. But there's one more item that has to be put in there. If I'm going to talk about building a system to do this, which is what I'm talking about, then one thing I have to look at is threats to the system. What can be done to make it not work? And you gotta believe there are going to be people who don't want a system like this to work. I hate to say that, but there will be people, for whatever reason, religious, cultural, political, would just as soon see country A get smacked in the perhaps vain belief that their country B is going to get through this just fine and gain some advantage. That is a fact of life. Obviously, the asteroid impact itself doesn't threaten command and control for warning. It hasn't happened yet, but how we do business today most certainly does open up some potential threats. Most of what the astronomical community uses to communicate this information is what I would call insecure. You're on the internet, you're using telephones, you're sending faxes and telegrams and whatnot back and forth. And there's not a whole lot you can do to guarantee the security of that. If we are to view planetary defense as an integrated system, then we have to believe someone's going to want to get into that system and spoof it. So in some fashion, we're going to have to deal with preserving data integrity. That would be the absolute bottom line. All right, so that is what sounds like the bad news. All that really does is tell me what my desired solution is, where I have to go. My choice of colors on the grid all that great. Each of the pieces, notification of the U.S. leadership, I rather arbitrarily chose the President, the National Security Council, Secretaries of Defense and Interior, and FEMA as perhaps the key individuals. We can add to that list, we can subtract from it, but that's probably the core of the group of people in the United States that would be responsible to responding to an impact threat. Other countries will have similar lists. They must get timely, assured information. Everything we've been talking about has to get to them, not only quickly, but in a form they can understand it, and that would be the trick. It has to come quickly. I would say if we can meet the current kinds of timelines that we deal with today in using the internet, we're probably passing information fast enough. There's plenty of time. Communications media does not impact the time for reanalysis, the cycle time to refine and update information. We need information sufficiency. And here is where we need to start integrating disciplines. Not only do we need the astrometric data, not only do we need to know the composition, potential composition of an impactor, but we also have to be able to talk about geologic responses when it hits. How bad are the earthquakes going to be? Can we estimate that? We have to talk about potential social and political responses. That information all has to be integrated and presented to the leadership. And I would submit this is a doable do. But I would also submit that we haven't looked that far into the problem to understand what we have to get and how we have to work it. Finally, this course of action development is the ultimate output of this whole process. Because after this, somebody is going to do something. They're going to launch some sort of response. They're going to put us all underground in shelters, all of deep impact. They're going to do something. So we have to be able to provide a variety of options. One answer will not be good enough, I'm here to tell you. That information has to be summarized to a level that these kinds of folks can digest. And we're going to be looking for abilities to output this information to various users with different levels of sophistication. This is probably where we get into an awful lot of new automation. But again, I think that path has been trod in other ways before. But we're going to have to do that. So I would say that's the outline of the desired solution. Now, one thing that typically does not happen in building requirements is to provide an example solution. But I'm going to do that anyway, just to kind of lay the outlines down where I think we ought to be going. And it's very, very broad brush. These steps, I would say we've got to go through, and we certainly can discuss them, are identifying the problem, identifying the threat, characterizing the threat, and you can't read it here, data, fusing data about that. And that's what I was talking about bringing all this mass of disparate data together and making it comprehensible so that we can provide that warning. Identification, we're already doing that. We've done a pretty good job of that, as a matter of fact. It's gotten a lot better over the past decade. The international astronomical community is absolutely bedrock. The JPL NEO program is doing a lot to try and pull it together. Obviously, the nexus of all this tends to be the Minor Planet Center. But I would say meeting that one gives us sufficient data and meets our timeliness requirements for that step. Characterizing it, at this point, still the astronomical community and JPL. And now we're beginning to talk about developing that course of action as well. But here's where we're not doing things yet. Data fusion. This is where we need to start to bring in partners that we don't have now. And I would submit to you that a partnership between JPL, between NASA and U.S. Space Command is probably an appropriate thing to look at. JPL has the connections back into that group of people that understand the asteroids itself. U.S. Space Command's got decades of experience in developing and providing warning to senior leadership. Rather complex issues summarized in very succinct statements that they can respond to. Because nuclear attack doesn't just mean launch everything back. There's a whole range of options for that. And that's what they've dealt with for decades. Finally, I would submit to you that warning has got, and this is going to probably get tomatoes thrown at me, warning has got to come from a source that the national leadership trusts absolutely. I would tell you that right now, if we were talking about an impactor that's 12 months out, as soon as NASA says it's coming, or the international astronomical community says it's coming, your national leadership is going to turn to the U.S. Space Command to confirm it. They can't do it, but they're going to turn to them to do it. Because at the moment, that is the trusted source of information. I'd suggest we leverage that, use that trust. So that's what I would suggest in broad outline we try and do. International implications. It's obvious that we are not talking about a problem that affects one region, one state, one city, one country. Impact of an asteroid is clearly a planetary issue. It's fundamentally international, not a question. The community that develops this information is fundamentally international and is used to free flow of information, not a question. There's no issue that notification should be shared. To my mind, and note the qualifier please, there's no issue that courses of action should be shared. But that is one opinion, and I am sure that there are others that are different. However, there are no existing international processes to address impact. You know, they're not there, and they're probably not going to be there very quickly. Why? There are huge policy and cultural differences between the players, i.e. every nation on this planet, that you have to address, that you have to address to build that international process. And as I pointed out, there are going to be conflicting desires because nations, by their very nature, are competitive and will seek advantage, which is why that sort of thing might not be shared openly as possible. My view of this then is that approaches are going to be ad hoc. They're going to be dealt with on a nation-by-nation basis. And I personally believe that what the United States does will end up being a template for many other nations. They will follow that approach to the degree that they can with the facilities and capabilities that they have. We will end up leading the parade, though, simply because we have got the broadest range of facilities to address this entire warning question. That pretty well sums up the briefing. The last slide is something we don't need to, I don't need to go over with us because we understand this. The only impact is probably the only natural catastrophe we can affect. To do that, the challenges are immense. And they cross the spectrum, they're technical, they're political, they're social. But we can do this. And rather than bury our heads in the sand, I would suggest we go ahead and start putting together the processes and the tools that we need to take that next step and provide comprehensive warning to people. And I'm done.
Processes that we'll have to address. There's the 20-meter diameter city buster that we aren't going to be able to inventory in short period orbits for decades that are going to be observed, if at all, on final approach. Okay. There's the short period comets and orbits of larger size that we are currently inventorying and we'll get a fairly complete inventory. When we're done with those, we're going to have about 80% or 90% of that population tied down. And then for all of those, it's either, not going to impact or it's going to impact, there's going to be possible impact decades in the future. The third thing in the is the objects like Kamikaze that gave us like a 3-month warning when it was first spotted before when it passed over Earth's North Pole. 10 million miles distance, putting on a hell of a spectacle 1 year before ALI. Those things, I think, only as so is this waste industrial civilization can really deal with. And that you're going to have to spot them when they're out of Saturn's orbit and have an intercept at Jupiter's orbit to disperse if you're reflected. It's a very different population to deal with when something's in a 25,000-year orbit.
Then what I would suggest to you is we deal with this the way we deal with any other threat. We look at the total threat population, and I'm not speaking very militarily, but in a sense, this is a military problem. We've got a very specific enemy. We have to deal with it in some fashion. I look at that threat population, and I initially address the portion of that threat that I can,
which is the short periods that we can identify.
Okay, I figure out a way to handle, to warn them, give sufficient warning, the right amount of information, so we can develop some way to deal with it. And I continue to try to figure out what to do with the threat that I can't handle yet. It's never going to be done in one fell swoop.
Right.
It's got to be bitten off and chewed in pieces. And I agree that some of those, it's going to be a long, long time, maybe centuries before we can properly deal with it. That doesn't mean
we should start. The thing is, they have these populations segmented in the discussion because they rarely are. Most people aren't aware of the different types of hazards.
Okay. Sir?
I've never heard of the titanium meteorite.
No, you haven't.
You mentioned that.
No, I was talking about a Delta II second stage rocket body.
Oh.
Sir?
Might the withholding of information from other countries lead to a suspicion that what you're preparing is an attack?
That's a distinct possibility. But our values are not necessarily, and I'm not picking anybody, I'm just picking someone with a fully different culture. Our values are not necessarily Chinese values or Iranian values or fill in the blank. What you say is a true statement, but we've just been through a 50-year Cold War where both sides withheld information that made things look very much like an attack. So, yes, I believe that can happen very easily. Yes, sir. No, you, sir.
From my point of view, the astronomy side, since I, in my talk, I showed the different level of the capacity, the lower capacity and the capacity. And from my astronomical standpoint, the lower capacity is very important issue for the human species.
Right.
And another one, from that standpoint, can be acceptable. You cannot say so much, right? From our point of view, I can say so. So we have to, at the moment, concentrate into the, such a big asteroid to detect up and give the plenty of the warning time. If one gets all the information, then we can give the when it will collide to the Earth.
Okay.
And for the small size, still we have a order of a million of the objects. And also additional to that, we have a comet, which can stretch forward here. And we have, at the moment, no idea from astronomical standpoint how we can detect up this whole object. And so it takes sometimes, they will say the century or something.
Okay. So
we have to divide the problem into two sides. One is the global catastrophe, other is the local catastrophe. So otherwise, things are always mixing up, and then very hard to understand what is going on.
And I think both you gentlemen have made essentially the same point, that one answer isn't going to cover all the potential things that you have to deal with. And I agree with that. I would say that the picture I've just painted is actually a level above what both of you are talking about. I would say that first we have to admit, as a nation, as a confederation of nations, as a planet, that we need to take that next step and rationally think through what kind of warning we want, what kind of responses we want. That's not happening in a concerted effort yet. Yes, sir?
Yes. I was wondering maybe if they have considered the possibility, I guess if it's a large asteroid or too large to deal with, if they considered maybe hitting it with it, maybe redirecting half of the smaller asteroid to hit the larger asteroid.
I have no. I know that there was a classified conference at Sandia in 1992. I know that work has been going on since then, talking about deflection, destruction and deflection options. And I know there's a raging debate behind closed doors because of the kinds of tools that you'd have to use. But all I'm taking us up to is the point of saying what. I've told you what's going on. I'm offering you options to deal with it. That might be an option. There will be others.
Bye.
What I actually do is the next step. And it's almost 6 o'clock, and you guys are going to beat me up if I keep you from the buffet. So I'm going to get off the stage. I'm going to stay here if you want to order it.
We're going to have a panel discussion tomorrow morning too, at the end of our session where we can talk about this. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.